welcome you all. The last concept in this module, that is fundamentals of logic theory, is methods of proof and disproof. In methods of proof and disproof, there are totally three methods: direct proof, indirect proof, and contradiction proof. We are going to do all these proofs by using the conditional statement P conditional Q. Now, in all these three proofs, there will be three steps. That is, the first step is hypothesis, the second step is analysis, and the third step is conclusion part. Hypothesis means that is an assumption. After the assumption is over, we have to analyze whether our assumption is correct or not. And the last is conclusion part. Now, here let's take the first one, that is a direct proof. Now, in the direct proof, the first step is hypothesis. Now, in hypothesis, we have to assume that P is true. Assumption is P is true. Now, in analysis, try to prove that Q is also true. One means true. In analysis, try to prove that Q is also true by using rules of inference or laws of logic theory. Once you have proved that both P is true, Q is true, this is a hypothesis, that's an assumption part. We have proved that Q is true. If both P and Q are true, in conditional, true, true will be true. What is a true? That is a conclusion part. The conclusion part is the given conditional statement will be true. This is in direct proof. Now, coming to that second method, the second method is indirect proof. Now, before moving to that indirect proof, we know that P conditional Q is logically equivalent to negation Q conditional negation P. This is a contrapositive of a conditional statement. Again, here there will be three steps. What are those three steps? The first one is hypothesis, second one is analysis, and the last one is the conclusion part. Now, in hypothesis, we have to assume that negation Q is true or Q is false. Both are one and the same. We have to assume that negation Q is true or Q is false. Both are similar. Okay. Now, in analysis, we have to prove that negation P is also true or P is false. Once you have proved that this is negation Q is true, negation P is true, in conditional, true, true will be true. Means the given conditional statement will be true. This is in the indirect proof. Now, the last method is contradiction proof. Now, in this contradiction proof, there are three methods, that is hypothesis, analysis, and conclusion part. In hypothesis, we are going to assume that P conditional Q will be false. P conditional Q is false only when P is true and Q is false. Now, coming to that analysis part, starting with the hypothesis that Q is false, we have to prove that P is also false by using rules of inference or laws of logic theory, which contradicts our assumption that P is true. Now, what will be the conclusion part? What we have proved here, P is false, again Q is false, this is our assumption. In conditional, 0, 0 will be 1. Now, what is that 1? The given conditional statement will be true. Now, let's move for the problems. That is, we are supposed to give a direct proof, indirect proof, as well as the contradiction proof for the given conditional statement. Now, what is that given conditional statement? If n is an odd integer, then n plus 9 is an even integer. Now, in this conditional statement, you can see two simple propositions, that is two simple statements. Here, the first statement is P, that is n is an odd integer. Denote this statement by P. What is your statement? N is an odd integer. Denote the statement by P. Then n plus 9 is an even integer. Denote this statement by Q. Now, in the given conditional statement, we will be having two simple statements. Denote those two simple statements by P and Q. Here P is n is an odd integer. Q denotes n plus 9 is an even integer. Now, see the first one, that's a direct proof. Now, in direct proof, we are going to prove this by using a conditional statement. The hypothesis is we have to assume that P is true. In analysis, try to prove that Q is also true. The conclusion part will be the given conditional statement will be true. Now, here let us assume that is true. Okay. Assume that P is true. Now, what is it? P, n, that is implies n is an odd integer. Implies n is an odd integer can be written as n equals 2k plus 1. Odd integer can be written as 2k plus 1, where k belongs to set of all integers. If the value of k is 1, if the value of k is 1, we will get 2 into 1 is 2, 2 plus 1 is, we will get 3. That is an odd number. If the value of k is 2, 2 into 2 is 4, 4 plus 1 is, 4 plus 1 is 5. Again, that is an odd number. If you are going to give the value of k is 3, 2, 3 is 6, 6 plus 1 is 7. You will get the odd numbers. N is an odd integer. N is an odd integer can be written as n equals 2k plus 1, where k belongs to set of all integers. Now, what exactly we are supposed to prove? We are supposed to prove that q is also true. Q is also true means we have to prove that n plus 9 is an even integer. To prove that n plus 9 is an even integer, just we are supposed to prove that n plus 9 is a multiple of 2. Multiple of 2 means that is an even integer. Okay. Now here to get n plus 9 here, adding 9 on both sides, that is n plus 9 equals 2k plus 1 plus 9. Adding 9 on both sides, n plus 9 equals 2k plus 1 plus 9 is 2k plus 10. What we have to prove? This is a multiple of 2. N plus 9 equals, taking 2 outside, you will get k plus 5. N plus 9 is a multiple of 2. 2 into something. Multiple of 2. Multiple of 2 means n plus 9 is an even integer. That is n plus 9 is an even integer. Now assumption is P is true. We have proved that Q is also true. Therefore, the given conditional statement is true. This is the conclusion part. Now, coming to that second method, that is indirect proof. Now, indirect proof, we know that P conditional Q is logically equivalent to negation Q conditional negation P. Now, what is our assumption? Now, let us assume that negation Q is true. Now, what is that negation Q? Opposite to that Q. Negation Q means this is Q. Negation Q is n plus 9 is not an even integer. N plus 9 is not an even integer means n plus 9 is an odd integer. This is our assumption. N plus 9 is an odd integer can be written as 2k plus 1, where k belongs to set of all integers. You got the concept now. Now here n plus 9 can be written as 2k plus 1, where k belongs to set of all integer. Now what we have to prove? Negation P is true. Now what is that negation P? N is not an odd integer. Not an odd integer means we have to prove that n is an even integer. N is an even integer means it should be a multiple of 2. Now take this 9 to RHS part, we get n equals 2k plus 1 minus 9. So n equals 2k minus 8. N equals, taking 2 outside, we will get k minus 4. This is a multiple of 2. Therefore, n is an even integer. N is an even integer. Even integer means opposite to the statement. Therefore, negation P is true. Assumption is negation Q is true. We have proved that negation P is also true. Therefore, the conclusion is the given conditional statement is true. Now, here the last method is contradiction proof. Now, in contradiction proof, we are going to assume that P conditional Q is false. Now, this P conditional Q will be false only when P is true and Q is false. Okay. Starting with the hypothesis that Q is false, we have to prove that P is also false. Once we have proved that P is false, the given conditional statement will be true, because in conditional 0, 0 is 1. Now, what exactly we have to do? Assume that Q is false. assumption is Q is false. Now what is that Q? Here Q is n plus 9 is anywhere integer. Is false. Is false means n plus 9 is an odd integer. We have to assume that Q is false. Q is false means n plus 9 is not anywhere integer means n plus 9 is an odd integer. What exactly we have to prove? P is false. P means n is an odd integer. P is false means n is an even integer. We have to prove that n is an even integer means n should be a multiple of 2. Now here n plus 9 is an odd integer can be written as n plus 9 equals 2k plus 1 where k belongs to set of all integers. Now take this 9 to RHS part. N equals 2k plus 1 minus 9. N equals 2k minus 8. Taking 2 as a common factor, we get 2 into k minus 4. Multiple of 2 means n is an even integer. Now what we have proved? N is an even integer. N is an odd integer, that is P. N is an even integer means negation P. Means P is false. What we have proved now? P is false. Okay, P is, N is an odd integer. P is false means N, what we have proved is N is an even integer. Assumption is Q is false. By analysis we have proved that P is also false. Therefore, the given conditional statement will be true. That is in conditional 0, 0 will be 1. Logically equivalent to negation Q, conditional negation P. Now what is our assumption? That assumption is, let us assume that negation Q is true. Now what is that negation Q? Here Q is, N is odd. What will be negation Q? Negation Q is N is not odd. N is not odd means N is even. Now even can be written as a multiple of 2. So I'll be writing 2k, okay, where k belongs to set of all integers. If the value of k is 1, we get 2 into 1 is 2. If the value of k is 2, 2 into 2 is 4. Multiple of 2 is always an even integer. Now what exactly we have to prove? Negation Q is true. Negation P is also true. We have to prove that negation P is true. Negation P means n square is even. P is n square is odd. Negation P means n square is even. To prove that n square is even, we have to prove that n square is a multiple of 2. Just a simple concept. Now we got n. To get n square, squaring on both sides, we will get n square equals 2k whole square. Right, 2k whole square. That is n square is 2k whole square is 4k square. 4k square can be written as n square equals 2 into 2k square. Again, this is a multiple of 2. What we have proved? N square is a multiple of 2. Multiple of 2 means n square is an even integer. Even means not odd. That is, negation P is true. Assumption is negation Q is true. We have proved that negation P is also true. Therefore, the given conditional statement will be true. This is by using indirect proof. Now, I will solve the problems based on logically equivalence, that is, without constructing the truth table. We are supposed to prove that the LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. That is, by using laws of logic theory, we are supposed to prove that the LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. Now here the RHS part is P conjunction Q. I will write here. Now in the solution, the first thing is we are supposed to consider the LHS part. Again, this is logically equivalent to, now imagine this entire function is A, this function is B. Now it is of the form A conditional B. Now what will be the formula for A conditional B? The formula for A conditional B is negation A disjunction B. Now let's apply the formula in this step. A conditional B is logically equivalent to negation A, that is negation of negation P disjunction negation Q, disjunction B. B means this entire function. That is P conjunction Q conjunction R. Okay. Now in this step we have applied this formula. Now see the last compound proposition, that is P conjunction Q conjunction R. Here all the symbols are similar. If all the symbols are similar, then we can apply law of associative. That is applying the brackets or changing the brackets. Now what I'll do is I will apply the brackets for the first two terms. That is P conjunction Q. See the next one. Again, this is logically equivalent to negation of A disjunction B can be written as negation A. Negation A means negation of negation P, that is P conjunction negation of negation Q. Negation of negation Q is Q. Again, disjunction of P conjunction Q conjunction R. Now in this step we have applied law of De Morgan's as well as double negation. In this step we have applied law of De Morgan's as well as law of double negation. Again, this is logically equivalent to, now imagine this entire function is A. Now if we have imagined this function as A, then what about this function? Again, this function will be A. Okay, then imagine this function as B. Now it is of the form A disjunction of A conjunction B. A disjunction of A conjunction B will be logically equivalent to A. A means P conjunction Q. Now in this step we have applied law of absorption. Now this is the RHS part. Therefore the LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. Now see the next problem. We are supposed to prove that the LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. Now consider the LHS part. Your LHS part is, okay, just remember this, the RHS part should be R. Now this is logically equivalent to negation P. Now here the symbols are similar. So we can apply law of associative, just changing the brackets. Now this is of the form A conjunction of B conjunction C. The brackets is for the last two terms. Now what I'll do is I will apply the brackets for the first two terms, that is negation P conjunction negation Q conjunction R. Disjunction of, see the next one, Q conjunction R disjunction P conjunction R. Now Q conjunction R is logically equivalent to R conjunction Q. Disjunction of P conjunction R is logically equivalent to R conjunction P. Now in this step we have applied, that is changing the bracket means law of associative as well as commutative law. Here we have applied associative as well as commutative. Now in the next step, again this is logically equivalent to, now imagine this entire function is A, this function is B. Now A conjunction B is logically equivalent to B conjunction A, that is R conjunction of negation P conjunction negation Q. Now here we have applied law of commutative, right, disjunction of, again here there are two compound propositions. In these two compound propositions the first term and the next symbol are similar, so we can apply law of distributive. Now what is that law of distributive? write the first term, next symbol, open the bracket, the second term, middle symbol, and the last term, that is P. Now in this step we have applied law of commutative as well as distributive. Again, this is logically equivalent to, write the first term, conjunction of negation P conjunction negation Q will be logically equivalent to negation of P disjunction Q. Now, which law we have applied here? Law of De Morgan's. Again, disjunction of, I will be writing the second compound proposition as R conjunction of Q disjunction P will be logically equivalent to P disjunction Q. Now here I have applied De Morgan's in the step, De Morgan's as well as commutative. This is by using De Morgan's as well as commutative. Again, this is logically equivalent to. Now here there are two compound propositions. Again, in these two compound propositions, the first term, see the first term and the next symbol are similar. So, which law we can apply here? That is law of distributive. Now, what is that law of distributive? Write the first term, next symbol, open the bracket, second term, the second term is negation of P disjunction Q, then middle symbol and the last term, that is P disjunction Q. In this step, we have applied law of distributive. Now, what is that law of distributive? Law of distributive will be A conjunction of B disjunction C will be logically equivalent to A conjunction B disjunction A conjunction C. Now, next is, again, this is logically equivalent to R conjunction of. Now, if you are going to imagine this function as A, this function as A, then what about this function? This function will be negation A. Now, it is of the form A disjunction of negation A. Now, what is that A disjunction of negation A? That is logically equivalent to T naught. Now, in this step, we have applied law of inverse. Okay. Now, R conjunction T naught is logically equivalent to R. This is by using law of identity. Now, this is the LHS part. Therefore, LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. What is the law of identity? Law of identity will be P disjunction F naught is P, then P conjunction T naught is P. Now here R conjunction T naught will be R. This is by using law of identity. Okay. Now see the next one. We are supposed to prove that P conditional of Q conditional R is logically equivalent to P conjunction Q conditional R. Now what is that RHS part? I will write here P conjunction Q conditional R. This is the RHS part we are supposed to get. Now, what we have to do is, we have to consider the LHS part. Consider the LHS part. Now, this is of the form, imagine this term is A and this entire function is B. Now, it is of the form A conditional B. Now, what is the formula for A conditional B? Now, this is logically equivalent to negation A disjunction B. Now, A conditional B is logically equivalent to negation A. Negation A means negation P disjunction B. B means Q conditional R. Now, in this step, we have applied this formula. Okay. Again, this is logically equivalent to, I will be writing negation P as it is. This is negation P disjunction of. Again, I will apply the same formula here. That is Q conditional R is logically equivalent to negation Q, disjunction R. Okay. Now here there are three terms, like there are three propositions. In all these three propositions, see the symbols here, the symbols are similar and the brackets is for the last two terms. Now I will change the brackets for the first two terms. Now which law I will apply now? That is by using law of associative. Changing the brackets for the first two terms. Negation P, disjunction, negation Q, disjunction R. Now in this step we have applied law of associative. Now here negation P, disjunction, negation Q is logically equivalent to negation of P, conjunction Q. Right, the last term as it is disjunction R. This is by using law of De Morgan's. Now what is that law of De Morgan's? Law of De Morgan's is negation of P disjunction P conjunction Q will be logically equivalent to negation P disjunction negation Q. Now imagine this function as A. Okay, not this entire function. Now this is of the form negation A and this term is B. Now it looks like negation A disjunction B. Now what is that negation A disjunction B? This can be written as A conditional B. That is by using this formula. Negation A disjunction B can be written as A conditional B. Now applying that formula, now what is that A? I have not taken this entire function as A. The function is P conjunction Q as A. A means P conjunction Q conditional B. Now what is that B? R. Again I have applied the same formula. Now what is the RHS part we are supposed to get? P conjunction Q conditional R. This is the RHS part. Therefore LHS is logically equivalent to the RHS part. Now see the next problem. Again we are supposed to prove that LHS part is logically equivalent to the RHS part. Now consider the LHS part. Here the RHS part is, I will write here P disjunction Q disjunction R. This is the RHS part. Now consider the LHS part, write P disjunction Q disjunction of. See first two terms, negation P conjunction negation Q can be written as negation of P disjunction Q, right? The last term as it is conjunction R. Now here this is by using which law we have applied? Negation P conjunction negation Q can be written as negation of P disjunction Q. This is by using law of De Morgan's. Again this is logically equivalent to. Now imagine this function as A, this function as B and this function as C. Now it is of the form A disjunction of B conjunction C. This can be written as A disjunction B conjunction A disjunction C. Now which law we have applied here? Law of distributive. Now let's apply that law. That is A disjunction of B conjunction C is A, that is P disjunction Q, A disjunction B. Now what is that B? Negation of P disjunction Q. A disjunction B conjunction of A disjunction C. Now that A is P disjunction Q disjunction R. Here we have applied law of distributive. Again this is logically equivalent to. Now imagine this function is A. Now what about this function? This function will be negation A. Now what is that A disjunction negation A? A disjunction negation A is logically equivalent to T naught. This is by using law of inverse. Again conjunction of, I am going to write the last compound proposition as it is. that is P disjunction Q disjunction R. Now in this step we have applied law of inverse. Again this is logically equivalent to, now imagine this function as A, this entire function as B. A conjunction B is logically equivalent to B conjunction A, that is P disjunction Q disjunction R conjunction T naught. This is by using commutative. Now imagine this entire function is A. A conjunction T naught will be logically equivalent to A. A means P disjunction Q disjunction R. This is by using law of identity. Now what exactly we are supposed to prove is P disjunction Q disjunction R. This is the RHS part. Therefore LHS is logically equivalent to the RHS part. The last problem is we are supposed to prove that this compound proposition is a tautology. Tautology means we are supposed to prove that this compound proposition is logically equivalent to T naught. This is the RHS part we are supposed to get. Okay. Now consider LHS part. P biconditional Q biconditional of, now the easiest way. Now P conditional Q conjunction Q conditional P is logically equivalent to P biconditional Q. You know the formula for P biconditional Q. P biconditional Q can be written as P conditional Q conjunction Q conditional P. So I have written here P conditional Q conjunction Q conditional P as P biconditional Q. Okay. Now here imagine this function as A and this function as B. Now it is of the form A biconditional B. What is the formula for A biconditional B? The formula is A conditional B conjunction of B conditional A. Now we are supposed to apply this formula, that is A biconditional B is logically equivalent to A conditional B. Now what is that A? A is P biconditional Q A conditional B. Now what is that B? P biconditional Q. Okay. A conditional B conjunction B conditional A. Now what is that B here? B is P biconditional Q conjunction, conditional A. Now what is that A? P biconditional Q. I have applied this formula A biconditional B. See here, A biconditional B is logically equivalent to A conditional B conjunction B conditional A. Okay. Now here imagine this entire function is A. Now what about this function? If you have imagined this entire function as A, then this function is also the term A. Okay. Now A conjunction A is logically equivalent to A. A means P biconditional Q conditional of P biconditional Q. In this step we have applied law of idempotent. A conjunction A is A, that is by using law of idempotent. Now here imagine this function is A and this function is B. Just imagine this function is A, this function is B. Now it is of the form A conditional B. Now we know the formula for A conditional B. The formula is, this is logically equivalent to negation A, that is negation of P biconditional Q disjunction B. B means P biconditional Q. P by conditional Q. In this step, we have applied the formula A conditional B is negation A, disjunction B. See the last step. Now imagine this function as A. Now what about this function? This is negation A. A disjunction negation A is A disjunction negation A will be T naught. A disjunction negation A is logical equivalent to T naught. Now that is by using law of inverse. Now what we have proved, the LHS part is logical equivalent to T naught. This is by using law of inverse. This step is by using law of inverse. Therefore, the given compound proposition is tautology. Okay.